Marcus Iutor, Astrotos Joy. For we are chaste, and all the hopes we have, we place on you right now.
Yeah.
Today is the last of the great day of the feast. And it is time for war. Hallelujah. I want us to recognize the presence of Pastor Ayoba Nyanalapo. All the way from Kigali, Rwanda. It's always around when important things are happening in the world, Jesus. I just saw an SMS early in the morning. I'm on my way to Nairobi. I will see you in the morning. So I calculated that must be the night. So I think you must be around. So I will say, hallelujah. Let me start the killing, then he will join me. Are you ready? Night of judgment and justice. That is what we have today. Tomorrow we shall be dealing with evil foundations. Saturday is for couples. And then Sunday is friends and family Sunday. In the name of Jesus Christ. Alright, let's go. The topic is time to kill. Time to kill. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 from verse 1. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 from verse 1. From verse 1 to 3. The Bible says, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck. A time to pluck up that which is planted. Verse 3, my emphasis. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break. A time to break down and a time to build up. I want to click on one side. It says, a time to kill. So today is time to kill. Hallelujah. Time to kill. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 to 22. See, there is time for everything. Today's oath is time to kill. There is time for everything under heaven. It's time to kill. I want to justify it because some people will be wondering, this apostle is always very dangerous. Every time he prays dangerous prayers, we'll be doing justice. Today is judgment day. We'll be doing justice, praying for many things, but now is judgment day. Matthew chapter 5 from verse 21 to 22. The Bible says, ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill. And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. The Bible says in verse 22, but I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raka or idiot, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. So when you read that scripture, you conclude very quickly that Jesus was saying that we should not kill. Amen? That you conclude very fast that Jesus was saying we should not kill. Alright, let me give you the clause. You know, I did a little bit of law when I was in year one. We did law 101. And they taught us that there are something called clause. Am I correct, sir? I didn't forget. They said, no, there are something called clause. Let us check the clause by which we will not kill. Number one, see? But I say unto you, whosoever is angry with, number one, his brother. With his what? I didn't hear your English. Brother. So, the only reason why I won't kill you is if you're my brother. And I will show you what qualifies you to be my brother. He said, God said we should not kill. Where did Jesus modify it and said the reason why you should not kill is the person must be number one, your brother. And number two, without a cause, the person must not do something that warrants to be killed. Without a cause. So whoever is angry with his brother, without, so that brother must be, for you to be a brother, you must not cause something that will make somebody kill you. For you to be a brother. So if you are not a brother and you do something that you must be killed, excuse me, sir, you are dying as I'm talking. In fact, you are dying as I'm talking, as I'm preaching and you're inspiring, as I'm talking, whether you're in the village, no matter where you are. Fucking you are dead in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I don't
he finishes. Okay, let me do a little bit more to the child. Okay. Let me show you who a brother is. What qualifies you to be a brother? Before the wounding begins, but the wounding have already started. Matthew chapter 12, verse 46 to 50. Matthew 12, 46 to 50. Let us check who a brother is. Okay. Ask your neighbor, hope you're my brother. Are you my brother? Okay, my brother, you better make up your mind. Because I will kill anybody who is not your brother that's attacking you. Okay. While he had talked to the people, behold, his mother and his brethren stood without, or they stood outside, desiring to speak with him. Who was this? Jesus. The next verse of the Bible says, then one said unto him, behold, thy mother and thy brethren stand without, desiring to speak with thee. The next verse. The Bible says, but the answerer said unto him, that told him, who is my mother and who are my brethren? The next verse. The Bible says, and he stretched forth his hand towards his disciples and said, behold, my mother and my brethren. The next verse, for whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. Excuse me, sir. If you are not doing the will of God, you are not a disciple. You are not a brother and you are not a mother. Therefore, anybody that are not falling to this category, attacking my life, attacking my marriage, you are dying this moment. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, you will attack me no more. You will trouble me no more. You will trouble my home no more. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, it's the name.
Are you sitting?
Whoever is doing what? The will of my Father. So if you are not doing the will of God in my life, you are doing the will of devil, you will die. After the mother left, in the name of Jesus Christ. You are doing the will of devil, you are finished. No matter where you are hanging. You pretend to be a brother, you are not a true one. Every true brother must do the will of God in your life. That's what it says. Every true brother must be the person doing the will of God, but another one scattering the will of God in your life. Everybody scattering the will of God, it's not your brother, it's not your mother, it's not your sister. It's not related to you. It's an enemy. Hallelujah. Are you still here? Have you understood now? So am I permitted to kill? Child, is it to leave your mind? Zamu, Zamu. Bilele, na bilele. Amina. Nasema, sante. I don't know the meaning, but that song is ringing in my spirit. Whatever, 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 Sunday. For me, Master. This is what it was. This is the beginning side. Nasema, Sunday. Wa wema, wako. Hallelujah. Okay, let's go. Acts chapter 7, chapter 11, verse 7. Amplified version. Time to kill. Acts chapter 11, verse 7. Amplified version. So you can get the straight English. Acts 11, verse 7. Everybody can read it. And I heard a voice saying to me, get up, Eric. Kill and eat. Excuse me, sir. In life, there are some things you will never enjoy until you kill. You must kill something before you eat. If you don't kill, you won't eat. The reason why they've been starving you is because you've not been killing some things. The hour has come for you to kill some things, kill some people, kill some animals, kill some devils, kill some angels of the devil. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I command the killing angels to show up. It is your time to eat. Who am I preaching for today? This year you will eat. I said this year you will eat. saying to Peter, arise, Peter, kill, and then you eat. So if you don't kill, Hakuna eat. He will stay there, he will starve. So this is New Testament. So God says, he quoted from both testaments. This one is a New Testament. Hallelujah. There are things that must die before you eat. If you don't kill them, Hakuna eat it for you. You will starve. You will die the way you are. There are people that must expire. Oh, let me show you how to kill them. Can I go ahead? 1 Samuel 17, verse 9. 1 Samuel 17, verse 9. So we see. So you have to understand. Because when I tell you to pray, you pray with confidence. Not you say, hey, we are only obeying apostles, so he doesn't think we are witches. We are witches, okay, fine. Die, you are checking here. We will not have a Samuel. I didn't really want to kill this guy. But we are just obeying apostles because his eyes are very red, everything. Very red jacket, red everything today. Before he becomes a witch. No, no. In case you find mercy, fine. But I'm shouting, die, because apostles will do it. You will do it spiritually. Let's go. 1 Samuel 17, verse 9. Are you there? The Bible says, if he be able to fight with me and to kill me, then will he be your servant. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall he be our servant and serve us. One man determined the destiny of an entire nation. Goliath speaking here. He said, if I kill that one man that you will bring, I will take over. All your people will come as slaves. But if he kills me, all my nation will become a slave to you. Now listen, who you kill determines who you serve and who serves you. Who you kill determines who you serve and who serves you. Who you kill? I have had this judgment mentality for a long time. I don't bring it out every time. I bring it out once in a while. Bring it out when it is time. But because God told me, don't kill people until I ask you to. I said, okay, sir. Because a few times I have spoken and things have gone in some torturous way. So God told me, until I tell you, I said, okay, sir. Sometimes I feel like bringing it out. Then the thing holds me back and I hold it. But today, it's already out. Before I kill, it's already out. Per second, there is casualty everywhere. Whoever is looking at you, that eye of evil, planning for you, you already died. You will hear the news. Per second, as the service is running, things are happening everywhere. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Goliath said, whoever kills me, as soon as he kills me, my country will submit to you. But if I kill that fellow, your country will submit. The reason why many people are in trouble is because there is no killer in their midst. The reason why your family has shamed is because there is no brother carrying sword in your family. Everybody, they are all very loyal Christians. Like John the Baptist, I was very loyal until the cut of his neck. I will never be that loyal. Cut my neck before you finish, I'll finish you. Before you even think of it. In fact, I'll be telling you death before you even think of it. Hallelujah. Goliath said, whoever kills me, it will cause submission of my entire nation. So if you refuse to kill Goliath, sorry for you. Your family remains slaves forever. And the only thing that can settle this score is healing. See, there are people that will never repent. I repeat it, they will never repent. There are some wicked who have made up their mind to be forever wicked, forever. They are agents of the devil packing like that forever, permanently wicked, they can't change. So if you're waiting for them to change, you will die and they're around. They will suck your blood and drink it like pure water. And you will expire and they're sitting around. And you're waiting for them to repent. Now lie. The hour has come. Anyone that is addicted to evil, anyone that is adamant, an enemy that will never change, I terminate you today. First Samuel 2 verse 6. Who does the killing? Everybody can read it together. One, two, go. Sorry. I'm not even carrying my back on somebody that is alive. Who does it give? God. You open your mouth and say, die! God shows up. And he moves the person's life. That's all. Now, the word of God that says you will not kill, the word of God that says you should not kill, means don't commit murder. Don't carry people and cut off their neck. Don't shoot people physically with God. But open your mouth and decree, and the Lord goes to do the killing. I will show you the Bible. Because I know it's a very tough topic. Everybody's wondering, how is this apostle child? Because once a year we do this killing service. Once a year. Hallelujah. Alright. Let me show you something in the Bible. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12. We are not fighting human beings. That is why God was helping with the killing. Who we are fighting is not human. Some of them are in, they are spirit inside human beings. Fine. But when you attack the spirits by the word of God, God does not need killing physically and spiritually. But therefore we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Excuse me, who are we fighting? We are fighting demons. Number one, principality. Two, power. Three, rulers of the darkness of this world. Three, spiritual wickedness in high places. These spirits enter into human beings, so you cannot kill them with God. Neither can you discover that to kill them, but God killeth them. The Lord killeth them. So if you have entered into any human being, God will expire them on your behalf. Are you hearing me, somebody? God will kill them by himself, but you must open your mouth and speak their killing to manifestation. If you don't speak their killing to manifestation, they will remain where they are. Because the Bible says, after I've had them speak in my ears, so we went to that stuff at 14, 28 to 28, 14. He said, after I've had them, so you must speak and God hears, then God does it. You must speak. If you don't speak and God hears, your enemy will remain there and kill you. And one of the bad things is that some of them, after killing you, they can run and repent. They have mercy on you. I'm very sorry. And God says, you are forgiven after they finished you. Excuse me, sir. Jesus came to die. Eric did not come to die. Now, I will meet my full length on that. None of my children came to die. Because if they die now, who do they want to save? Are they saved? Your savior or who? None of them will die. My wife is not sent to go and die. Jesus has already died. So I'm not going to waste my blood. And that's why I call it to waste your blood. If you die, you only waste it. So anybody who wants to kill you, but when they were killing Jesus, they were helping to fulfill destiny. That's why I said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They did not know that by killing Jesus, they helped to fulfill destiny. Now if they kill you now, they don't know what they are doing. They are inspiring you, don't know what they are doing, don't you? Jesus said, they don't know. On my own, they know. You attempt to kill me, you already dead. In the name of Jesus Christ, you attempt to slow down this ministry, you attempt to slow down my destiny, you are already dead. In fact, just trouble me 1 second. I declare you expired. As I'm talking, they are dying. In the mighty name of Jesus, every nation on earth that is represented in this world, represented by their flags here, I speak to them. Nobody can kill me. Nobody can kill a world changer. Whoever is anywhere, they did not know that by killing Jesus, they helped him. When they killed him, what help are they helping you to do? Excuse me, don't kill him here. You can't kill him. Let's be a little bit more. Are you following me? Oh, somebody say thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Exodus 20, verse 13 says, thou shalt not kill. Because when you go down to say in your church, they kill. That must be a bad church. You sit back and understand the Bible. Say, thou shalt not what? Kill. Alright, let us get amplified version to show the root word they are killed. Let's get the actual root word of the word. Alright, let's go. Everybody can read. You shall not commit murder. What is murder? Catching somebody and cutting his neck, or shooting him, or pushing him and he falls down dead, or making sure he's that is strangled, that one is what they're talking about. But open your mouth and say, die. Over permission is what in our God is the one that will do that. He will supervise the nation. For you carry knife. Ah! Have you understood now? You shall not commit murder. When you are reading your Bible, go down to read it. Don't read the holy. So you are not confused. Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. Let me clear some things in the Bible. Matthew 5, 44. The Bible says, I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. Now listen, there are different kinds of love. For example, if your son commits a sin and then you flog him to gather his head back into motion, is that not love? Do you know if you leave that boy and he messes up and grabs that as you hate that boy, you are an idiot. You didn't hear? Ah, imagine your son is going to the electric to put his hand inside the electric. And you tell him, don't go there, he's doing that, tell him, don't go there, and he's going. Now, if you slap him and he says, guess what, he doesn't put his hand. Is that not love? But if you need to slap him and he puts his hand there and like this shape, permanent smile and smiles into heaven, you will think you know that boy. In fact, demons will attack you. People that will beat you up at the gate, man, everybody will face you. Say, you are a wicked one. You saw your son going to put that hand in the and you didn't slap him, you didn't carry wood and hit him, even if you break one hand first. It is better than this child smiling permanently to hell. Am I talking now? Now, when God says love, it is loaded. He said, love your enemies. Very loaded. He said, bless them that curse you. He didn't give us the point of blessing. He didn't say, bless them and say, you are going to be rich. He said, bless them. I can bless you with thunder. I can bless you with health food. I'm telling you, I can bless you with anything. Bless is bless. He didn't tell us, bless them and give them money. Say, bless them. I can bless you with anything. You went further, say, do good to them that hate you. I can do good to you by dispatching you to hell. It is good because many people will be saved since you are corrosive and contagious, you are wicked. I can dispatch you to hell, and that is good. The Bible says, I'll pray. All right, excuse me, sir. Show me the prayer point here. I'll pray for them that not use you rightly. Despitefully use you and persecute you. What is the prayer point there? I will show you what the prayer results into. The prayer, I'm coming, we'll pray for that book so you can understand it well. I had to go down to there and hear it well so you can understand it. Are you still around? Let us check the prayer. Romans 12, 19 to 21 tells us the kind of prayer which we pray for the enemy. Romans 12, 19 to 21 tells us the prayer. He said, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves. He said, don't take vengeance for yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Who will fight for you there? Who will do the killing there? Who will do the vengeance for you? Who will revenge for you? Fine. Who is undertaking? He said, I will repay, saith the Lord. He said, you don't need to do the repayment. Say, therefore, if thy enemy hunger, do what? Let us stop the feed him. Did he say we got it? What did he say we should feed him? He just said, do what? Feed him. You can feed anybody with anything. Am I correct? I will show you what the feeding will result. If your enemy hunger, do what? The reason why your enemy is attacking is because he's hungry. And we are going to feed him now. Sure, I have enough for the enemy today. If your enemy hunger, do what? Feed him. Number two, he said, if he thirst, give him drink. Did he tell you any kind of drink? Soda, juice. He said, do what? Give him drink. Okay, let us read. Everybody can read the reading. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Stop there. What kind of food will you give somebody and it comes to fire on his head? What is this food you will give your enemy to eat and drink and then fire will not take on sale? And it will be heaping. You know, you will do what? heap gather, heap, cause of what? Cause of Ugali. Sorry, cause of Yamachoma. Cause of Pukujoma. Cause of what? Fire. Oga, when your enemy is hungry, give him the fire. When he's thirsty, give him the fire. When you see him more, the more you see him, the more you hear cause of fire in his head. Whoever is hungry for your blood, I give them the fire. Whoever is hungry for your flesh, I give them the fire. Whoever is hungry for his of your destiny, I give them the fire. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ,
the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violence taken by force, amplify it.